We now move to the second talk of the morning, which will be delivered by Professor Amol Dighe from the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research. Professor Amol Dighe is a professor of physics at TIFR. He is also currently the Dean of Graduate Studies at TIFR. His research area is high energy physics, which aims to understand the nature of fundamental interactions by studying properties of elementary particles. His recent research has focused on neutrinos, their nature, and the role they play in astrophysics and cosmology. So he also looks for signals for new physics at experiments like the Large Hadron Collider at CERN, Europe, you may have heard about it, and in the particles that come from the sky. Professor Dighe completed his BTEC in engineering physics from IIT Bombay. He went on to do an MS and a PhD from University of Chicago, where he explored signals of charge parity violation in particle physics interactions. He was a postdoctoral fellow at ICTP in Trieste, and CERN in Geneva, and Max Planck Institute for Physics in Munich, Germany. And he joined TIFR as a faculty member in 2003. And since then, he has been at TIFR. Amol is one of our first Olympiad medalists, actually. He was the first Indian bronze medalist in the International Mathematical Olympiad, which was held in Germany in 1989. That was the first year that India participated in any international Olympiad. That was a mathematical Olympiad. He has received the Institute Silver Medal from IIT Bombay and the World Lab CERN John Bell Scholarship. He was the leader of the Max Planck India Partner Group in Neutrino Physics and Astrophysics for 5 years. He has been elected fellow of the Indian Academy of Sciences and the Indian National Science Academy. He has won the Swarna Jayanti Fellowship from the Department of Science and Technology and is a recipient of the Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Award. I must mention that Professor Dighe is also actively involved with our Olympiad program. He has been a resource person and a mentor in as many as 3 of our Olympiads, physics, astronomy and astrophysics, and junior science. Professor Dighe.
Thanks, Anvesh, and thanks for having me here. As he told you, I'm almost a local person. I have been involved in many of the HBCSE activities, and therefore I closely know what this institution does. Today I'm not going to talk about the kind of things I'm doing my research. What about something interesting that has been happening as we speak? And which is that the kilogram is changing. Okay, the unit of mass that we all have grown up with for so long is changing as we speak. We are in the transition period, and something is going to happen in the next year. So that's something that I would like to tell you about. As Professor Ganesh told you at the beginning of his talk, the things that a scientist does is ask questions. So my talk will be focused on these questions about Mr. Kilogram. Okay, so I will first try to ask why, how, why now, what now, and what's the big deal? I mean, why is it that we worry so much about changing kilogram that people make a big fuss about it and have events about it and try to do these things? Okay, so what will happen during the course of this talk is presumably what I want to convey to you is some idea about how we think about units and the measurements and what all goes behind actually constructing these measurements and how so-called advanced things in physics, chemistry, and mathematics actually are behind simple things that we speak about like time, distance, and mass. Okay, so it's going to be something very simple. Okay, so I said goodbye, and you usually say goodbye to somebody who retires. The person who retires is actually called le grand cas. It's the French name for what they call as the what we call as the international prototype kilogram. So this person is actually referred to in masculine as a person. Okay, this weight. Okay? This is what this weight looks like. Okay, it's also called as the IPK or international prototype kilogram. It is this small cylinder that you see. It's a cylinder which has a diameter of about 4 centimeters, with more like 39 millimeters, because you have to be very, very precise now. Height also around the same, so it basically looks something like this. Okay. It's made up of iridium and platinum. If you see here, it's kept inside an evacuated bell jar. This bell jar you will see is inside another bell jar, evacuated. This bell jar is inside a third bell jar, and somebody thought that 3 was enough to protect it from any of the atmospheric disturbances. Okay, so we are here, and this is kept in the vault. The vault is opened very, very rarely, and it is opened to prepare replicas of this kilogram. So periodically, there are some other kilograms that you want to spread all around the world, which will carry the signature or the brand of exactly 1 kilogram. So every masses that we see in our grocery shops finally come after a very great chain of these kilograms which are weighed against each other at various places. Okay? This, however, is the so-called standard kilogram, which is the international prototype. This has been there since 1889, so it has a history of more than 125 years. So it looks a good idea, but there always are problems with having a physical object as standard. Okay? There are some very clear disadvantages. One is you are putting all your eggs in one basket. So if tomorrow something happens to this, and no, its weight changes a bit, then everything that you are doing is going to be off by certain quantities. There are things that we have to do now for which we need very good precision. And therefore, precision of the order of, so sometimes you have 1 in a million, and 1 in a billion is required in while doing certain things. Okay? And therefore, changing the definition of as basic thing as kilogram actually might be very precarious. And we have just to be careful that this object is known to as good a precision as possible. Second thing, which is not really scientific in a sense, but philosophical, is that it's very inconvenient and it's very undemocratic. Okay. Inconvenient simply in the sense that if tomorrow I do want to check whether something I have is, let's say, 500 grams or not, I have to go back the whole chain. And finally, it has to lead back to this vault in Paris. And somehow this thing kept in the vault in Paris has to be brought out only when those people will allow me to. Therefore, as a scientist, it's not that at any point of time I want, I have access to what is the standard of 1 kilogram. Okay? So in that sense, it's very undemocratic. Those who hold that piece have the standard available. Of course, it's inconvenient. What is more important scientifically is that in the last 125 or so years, this IPK could have changed by as much as about 50 micrograms. Now, how can it change? Of course, you take utmost care to make sure that nothing happens to it. But see, all said and done, when you want to make more replicas, you take it out. It's possible that a few dust particles will come settle on it. It's possible that there'll be some evaporation from the surface. It's possible that whatever you touch it with, maybe some, well, hopefully there will be no oil, but something will stick to it. So it's quite possible that the weights would change. We know that the weights have changed. The reason is because since 1889, we have made many, many, many replicas of this. And these replicas do not match to each other within about 50 micrograms. Okay. Now, of course, most of the replicas also have been, we are taking care of these replicas to a great extent. In spite of this, if you find a variation of about 50 micrograms within these replicas, it means that quite likely that our standard kilogram might also have changed by up the order of 50 micrograms. The worst part of it is we will never know. Okay, because by definition, that is the kilogram. Okay, so if that has changed over the last 100 years, we will never know. And that is a big disadvantage of having a physical object as a standard, because we know physical objects change. Okay? And that is the principle with which the metrologists, which means those who decide on the measurements, actually act. Okay? The question is, what is the alternative? Okay? I mean, everything, as was said in the last talk, as scientists who study the natural world, which means all that we have is things in nature, and we observe that things in nature change. Okay? Therefore, a priori, there doesn't seem to be a way out of this to define the something like mass. You must have something that you use as a standard. Okay, so the question is there a way out of it? Okay, and that's what we'll try to look at in this lecture. Let me tell you who are the people in charge of this. There is a CGPM, which is the General Conference of Weights and Measures. Then there is a CIPM, which is International Committee for Weights and Measures. There's a BIPM, which is International Bureau for Weights and Measures. And there's NIST in US, which is National Institute for Standards and Technology. All of these three things are in Paris. French were the people who started all of this, and therefore, somehow historically, French have been the leaders in looking at standards. These names that you see also are a French name. So this is Bureau International des Poids et Mesures, and so on. Okay. But we'll refer to them only as these four. All the information I have in this talk is taken from the websites of the organizations, plus, of course, some papers, plus Wikipedia Commons. So it's good to always say in your paper, for example, what you have been referring to. And that's also true for talks if you're, when you're referring to something major. So next question is how? How do we achieve, how do we go to a stage where we can define the kilogram without referring to any standard measure? Okay. To understand that, we will step back and we will look at another example. And that example is going to be the definition of a standard meter. Okay. So let's just go through some history and see how things developed. So of course, more than four or five centuries ago, people in various lands used various units. This was a digit. This was span, foot. I was talking to Anvesh today morning about why is foot equal to, this is an inch. Why is a foot equal to 12 inches? We never know. Maybe there was some person whose foot and inch had this ratio of 12. This was the cubit, this was hand, this was the fathom, this was a yard, and so on and so forth. Okay, so units were defined not very accurately, sort of conventionally. Okay. The first time that people thought of actually making nice units was after French Revolution. So somehow, at the time of French Revolution, there was also some change in mindset going. There were discussions happening in the French scientific community about actually having units which are standard. Okay. Before French Revolution, the second was actually defined as, the meter was defined as half period of a, as a length of a seconds pendulum. A seconds pendulum is the one where you take 1 second to go from one end to the other. Okay, so in the modern parlance, it means that the time period should be equal to 2 seconds. And that was therefore half period of a second, the second half period of a, okay, that's, it has half period of a second, okay? So that length was 1 meter. As we know, if you take a 1 meter pendulum, its time period is equal to 2 seconds. The problem with this was obvious even at that point of time, because if you measure it in Paris and if you measure it in some other place, since of course we know that G changes from place to place, the time period was different. Okay, so it was even observable because it depends on gravity. So very clearly, that could not have been a good definition of a second. The second definition that people thought of making depended on the Earth. Okay, so the second definition was actually based on the meridian of the Earth. So what decided was we will take the circle that passes, great circle that passes through Paris, of course, because Paris was the center of the world at that point of time. We know that the circumference of Earth is about 40,000 kilometers. That is not a coincidence. It is around 40,000 because the meter, as was defined first, was defined as 1 over 10 million of this. This part, which is 1/4 of the circle, is called as the half meridian. Meridian basically means pole to pole. This was half meridian. You measure this, you measure, take 1 over 10 million part of it, that would be a meter. Okay. Of course, this means that you have to actually measure the length of the meridian. There were people who went and did that by actually using rulers. There were expeditions that went around trying to go through each and every part of this meridian. So whenever it was sea, they went over sea. With land, they went over land. These expeditions actually tried to measure what this distance was. and from that figured out approximately what a meter was. Okay, so a meter actually has been defined with respect to Earth, which is something I learned very recently. I didn't know of this. It's quite fascinating. Okay, and from this, they decided what the length of a meter should be. In 1739, which is where this exercise was kind of over, they made this meter scale, which was called as the Battle Day Archives, which is meter in the archives. And it was claimed to have accuracy of about 0.1 millimeters, which is about 1 in 10,000, okay? So which is reasonable. So which means that the circumference of the Earth, this meridian, half meridian, was measured to an accuracy of about 1 in 10,000, which is fair compared to what we had at that point. Then, of course, people kept on making better and better measurements, or in fact making rods, which were equal to that original rod, which will not change its dimensions. So in 1875, there was a so-called International Treaty of the Meter. Okay, this is called as one of the scientific treaties. It's also called as the Meter Convention. I think there were 17 countries which were party to this. We decided that now we will hold this particular object and call it as a meter. It's called a standard meter. This was the prototype meter, which was made in 1889 and lasted till 1960. You see it has an expiry date. And expiry date, I'll come to later as to why it had an expiry date. This meter, which looked like this, was also made up of iridium platinum for the simple reason that these things are very stable. But of course, you know, an object like a meter, depending on temperature, will change the length, right? It has an expansion coefficient. So to define it very, very properly, it has to be at 0 degrees temperature, so 0 degrees Celsius. Depending on the pressure you have, there might be some expansion. You press it from top, this much thing might get spread. It has to be exactly at one standard atmospheric pressure. It also depends on how you measure it. Okay, if you put it on two supports, it is going to bend slightly. Okay, but you have to put it on two supports. One support is not possible. Depending on where you put the support, the length would change slightly. So it is very important to decide how you measure it. So not just the object, but how you measure the length of the object when you are trying to make other meters. Okay, so it is supported by two cylinders, separated at 571 centimeters. Okay, so you place one cylinder here. It's a very small one. One here, you balance it on these two, put them exactly in the center, and you measure the length. Okay, so you have to specify all of these three things, and when you do that, then you can measure the length of this meter to an accuracy of 2 micrometers. Okay, so in about 1880, we had gone to this level. However, again, we know that this already has many difficulties. You have to satisfy these three conditions. Again, it depends if you take 0 or 0.1, it's going to make some difference, and we do need to be as accurately as possible. Things were made but simple when we had quantum mechanics, okay, and chemistry, okay, atomic physics. So it was found with the advent of atomic physics that when there are atomic transitions, they correspond to very particular wavelengths, okay, which are very, very narrow. So if we choose a very narrow wavelength, we will know what that wavelength is. That will be maybe some nanometers, and then we say that if that is nanometer, you multiply by some number, you will go to get a meter. That's the principle. Okay. So this was based on the krypton lines. So these are the Barber series transitions of krypton lines. Basically, you are coming from n equal to 5 shell to n equal to 2 shell. This particular line, which has a wavelength of 434 nanometers. So in 1960, when the earlier meter was discontinued, the new definition was the following. It said, okay, fine, you measure the wavelength of light, which was this, then you multiply that by this number, 1,650,000, blah, blah, blah. Exactly these many wavelengths are going to form a meter. Okay. Now, of course, this has one great advantage that you don't have to go anywhere and measure the length of the meter. You can do the experiment in your own lab. All you need is a source like this, a krypton source, And in fact, many of these replicas were made and sent to many laboratories where they could make a meter scale of their own. Accuracy of this from 2 micrometers actually went down to 0.01 micrometers. Okay? So an increase in the factor by factor of about 200 was still not enough, because as was found later on when the technology developed and we found that with lasers we can make much sharper lines, it was found that this Krypton line that was earlier thought to be a very standard line is not standard. It has some asymmetry, and therefore there were problems in defining things well if you wanted to go to accuracy more than 0.01 micrometers. Okay? So in fact, in 1983, even this definition was discarded. So what did we do? Where did we go from here? So idea came from a very strange source. Okay. It came from what Einstein propounded in 1905, which was the special theory of relativity. One of the principles of special theory, which all of us know, is that the distance traveled by light, the speed of light in vacuum is a constant. Okay? And therefore, distance traveled by light in 1 second is going to be a constant. What does that mean? That means that if you know what is a second, and if you know what is the speed of light, you can define the meter by just saying that it is the distance traveled by light in so much time. Okay? So in fact, the definition adopted in 1983 was that a meter is a distance traveled by light in a vacuum in this much fraction of a second. Okay? This basically meant that this is the speed of light. Okay? In other words, meter now is that length, is that unit, in which speed of light is 299792458 meters per second. Okay? From 1983 onwards, the speed of light has not changed. Well, it did not change since the beginning of the universe, but the number corresponding to speed of light has not changed since 1983, and by definition, it will never change now. Okay? At least with accuracy of 1 in a million, these numbers are not going to change, because their speed of light is now not a quantity to be measured. It's a quantity used to define a meter when you are given a second. Okay? So it looks like a convoluted way of thinking, but actually it happens to be a nice and consistent way. It's going to last forever. So one of the mottos of this meteorologist is units for all and units forever. Okay, which means units should be such that they're accessible to everybody, and units should be something that should last forever. The definition will not have to change. Okay. Speed of light, as far as we know, is a universal constant. It's a constant of nature that does not change. So remember, we were looking for something which will be a standard, which will not change because of the handling of human beings, or because of rotation of Earth, or because of the falling on the floor. And we know that speed of light does not change. It's an abstract quantity. It's a constant of nature, but we know it exists, and we know that it does not change. So that principle is now going to be used in talking about all the rest of the units. Okay. Yeah. So we are in some sense back to defining distance in terms of time, right? When you thought of seconds pendulum, you first defined a second, and then you defined this length. Okay. So it might look that we are back to this, but it's slightly, of course, better than that, because now there is no dependence on what the source is. It doesn't depend on krypton or xenon or cesium or anything. Special relativity has been checked and is always checked by a multitude of experiments. So therefore, we are very, very confident that the value of C does not change. And what is more important is that a second can be determined with an accuracy of more than 1 in a trillion. So as we'll see later, we'll keep on defining all our units in terms of a second. Okay? Because of course, we need to somehow go to nature and ask it some question. No? What is the unit? We ask the question to nature only for second. So that's our compromise. Okay? So once you have defined this second very well, everything else will come out naturally. Okay? So that's what we are trying to see. So let's first understand how a second is measured, and then we'll come back to meter again. So the general idea is the following. A day has 24 hours, hour has 60 minutes, minutes has 60 seconds. Basically means that 86,400 seconds is a day. So you take whatever is the average day or a mean day, whatever the meaning is, and you take this fraction of this. Okay? Of course, extremely unsatisfying definition, because day change. Okay? Definition of mean day is variable, and therefore it cannot be very, very accurate. So here also, we go back to a quantity which you can measure very accurately, almost to one part in a trillion, and which is again going back to atomic transitions. So what is done is you look at cesium source, okay, cesium 55. This is a nucleus of cesium 55. These are orbits, n equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You look at the so-called 6s electron of cesium. It has some spin. You look at the proton of cesium, it has spin half. Okay. The transition which takes you from this, where both are spin up to one is spin down, is called hyperfine transition. This transition happens to have a very, very accurate measurement. Its frequency is known to, as you see here, 10 decimal places, and it is defined to be 9 trillion, 192 million, blah, 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 so many hertz. Okay. This is now taken as the sort of benchmark for measuring time, and a second is defined as this number, 9192, blah, 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 these many periods of the radiation corresponding to this particular cesium atom. Okay. This is an important measurement, because this is the measurement that is going to decide all your units. Okay. So at the end of the talk, we will see, once you can do this measurement, it means that you basically know all the units in SI system. Okay? But this is one that you really, really have to go back and measure. Okay. So what is the principle now? Principle that we learnt from the definition of meter. Firstly, you choose a definition of time measured on very, very accurate experiment, which is what we have done. Okay. Next step is you choose a fundamental constant of nature that does not change, which connects time and distance. So in this case, we have time, so t, distance is meters, so speed of light connects distance and time. We take that as a fundamental constant of nature, and that gave us the definition of meter. Okay. Now, next step, you have to measure this fundamental constant as accurately as possible. Because we know that once we fixed it, it's not going to change, the value will not change. We do not want to change the current values of meter and second as far as possible. So first thing you do is measure the value of this constant as accurate as possible and freeze the value. Okay? Just like I said, the speed of light now, well, for meter and second is not going to change. Okay? So you freeze the value of this constant, and now through this fundamental constant, you define 1 meter. So this definition of meter now is going to be everlasting definition. You will not have to change, because your standard has not changed. Okay? What could happen is you could maybe measure the time more accurately, but that's it. That's the only one measurement that you can do more accurately. Once you have that, everything else will follow. So let's come back to kilogram. Okay, so we are going to use that to define the kilogram now. So now you want to connect mass with distance and time, because those two you are defined well. So you can think of fundamental constants of nature which connect mass with time and distance. Turns out that such a constant exists, and it's called as Planck's constant. Okay? So anybody who has done quantum mechanics would know of Planck's constant. Okay? This connects energy and time. So it tells you that if you have got a photon with frequency f, its energy is E. And E is equal to Planck's constant times the frequency. E is equal to h nu. Okay? So this constant connects energy and frequency. Special relativity also tells you that E is equal to mc squared. Okay? So therefore, if you connect these two, you will see that A mass, therefore, can be defined in terms of Planck's constant, frequency means time, right, 1 over time, and C, another constant of nature. So what you have done, therefore, is you have related mass to these measurements, which are basically constants of nature and just one time measurement. Okay? So how will I define the kilogram based on Planck's constant? Okay. We use the same technique as before. We want Planck's constant to be equal to this. Okay? 6 point, this is the accurately measured value. And now that we have this value, we are going to freeze this value. Okay, in July 2017, the value was frozen. Okay, so since July 2017, your Planck's constant will not change. In fact, a kilogram will be defined in terms of Planck's constant. Okay, so the definition of kilogram, okay, can be defined in two ways. One way is this: it is that mass whose rest mass energy would be equivalent to a light with a frequency of 1/(so many, so many) hertz. That's what we are looking at. A second definition, which is exactly the same as this, is this. See, h is written like this. H is some number, kilogram meter square per second. If I change my unit of kilogram, h will change. Okay? In only one particular definition of kilogram, will h have this value. Okay? So I say that kilogram is that unit of mass in which Planck's constant has this value. We already defined meters and seconds earlier, so that already stays. Okay, so that's the principle on which Planck's constant is in the principle on which kilogram has been defined from Planck's constant. Okay, it's actually a big deal in the sense, first thing that we need for this is to be able to fix on what this value of Planck's constant is without changing what we currently think as kilogram. We don't want to suddenly start calling something else as kilogram. We want to be as close to current kilogram as possible. The question now is, why now? I mean, why is it that this was not done long ago? No, why is it suddenly people woke up in 2017 and said, okay, okay, let's now fix Planck's constant, no, this and this value. We could have done it even earlier, right? That's one question we can ask. Why didn't people think of this 100 years ago? People were good thinkers, they came up with ideas. But of course, the fact is that 100 years ago, we did not have the means or the technology to be able to do this. Okay. So for example, special relativity just getting established, no, it's 1918. Okay. No quantum mechanics, so of course, people didn't know of Planck's constant. Okay, Planck's constant was known at that time, okay. So that's not the correct statement, but there was no quantum mechanics as such. General relativity was just proposed. Okay, so we are in just infant stages of what our modern science consists of. Okay. Could you have done it 50 years ago, or 25 years ago, or 10 years ago? Okay, let's look at this question. Why is it that suddenly now we can do this and we are not able to do this earlier? Okay. So let's see what technology is needed to measure the value of H. Okay. So measuring H uses a very good technique, is called as watt balance. What a watt balance does, in fact, I'll show you a movie about this because the movie can explain that thing much better than me. It has some nice cartoons also. Instead of trying to balance by using masses on two sides, you use electromagnetic forces on one side. Okay, and that will allow you to measure the value of Planck's constant. Let me show you this movie. I think the sound is connected. So let's just.
An ordinary beam balance works by adjusting the amount of mass on one side of a beam so that its weight exactly balances the weight of a test mass on the other side. Gravitational force against gravitational force. A watt balance, for all its sophistication, does basically the same thing. In this case, however, the force that balances the weight of the mass is not gravitational, but electromagnetic. This force is produced by a coil of wire that is suspended in a strong magnetic field, created by stationary permanent magnets. The watt balance lets researchers determine the mass of an object indirectly by determining two quantities, the strength of the magnetic field, and the current running through the coil of wire. It does this in two separate measuring modes. The first, called velocity mode, uses an electric motor to move the coil through the magnetic field at a constant velocity. This movement induces a voltage in the coil that is exactly proportional to the field strength. Measuring the voltage indicates the field strength. In the second mode, called weighing mode, an electrical current is run through the coil to turn it into an electromagnet. As the coil's field interacts with that of the permanent magnets, an upward force is exerted proportional to the current, which can be measured. NIST's new watt balance uses a wheel instead of a balance beam. Attached to the wheel on one side is the coil and a platform for the test mass. On the other side is the motor that moves the coil in velocity mode. Both the coil and the motor are surrounded by metal enclosures. In velocity mode, laser sensors track the coil's motion using a technique called interferometry. This detects differences in position as small as a fraction of the wavelength of the laser light. As the motor moves the coil, the interferometry system ensures that the coil's motion remains perfectly constant. That constant velocity makes it possible to calculate the strength of the magnetic field. In weighing mode, a test mass is placed onto the platform on the same side of the balance as the coil. An electrical current runs through the coil, producing an upward force that is proportional to the current. By carefully adjusting the current, the upward force is tuned until it exactly offsets the weight of the test mass, and the system reaches equilibrium.
I had to watch the video about 17 times to be able to really figure out what's happening. So I don't expect you to have figured out many of you to in the first time, but of course there are people sitting here who are much smarter than I am. So I wouldn't be surprised if some of you have. But I wanted to show it to give you a feeling of what is it that was done in the last few years, from 2010 onwards, or around that time, to be able to balance the mechanical force, by that I mean the force of gravity, with the electrical force, which was used to push this mass up because of electrical forces. And that gives you the value of H. Okay. Now, people sitting here, like Ganesh, will immediately tell me that I am cheating, because I talked about mechanical forces, I talked about electrical forces, and as many of you know, they don't involve Planck's constant. So I showed you this slide, this movie, which actually did not mention Planck's constant. Okay, it said mechanical forces, electrical forces. Okay, so never get cheated by people who tell you that you do this and you measure Planck's constant. Okay, I didn't cheat. Okay, but I just hid something from you, which I'll tell you very soon. Okay, so the question was this: where does H enter? As physicists know, H basically enters when you are addressing some quantum phenomena. If the phenomena is completely classical, then H doesn't come into picture. Okay, there was somewhere was H hidden in all of these things. Okay, and in fact, that lies in how you measure these quantities. Okay, so remember that in all of this, what was very important is measurement of magnetic field, measurement of voltages and currents. Okay, now the most accurate measurements of magnetic field, voltages and currents actually needs quantum mechanics. So how? The current is measured using what is called as Josephson junction. Okay, so this is for people to go back and Google and see what is Josephson junction. This was discovered, effect was discovered by Josephson in 1962. Nobel was given in 1973. So this is something that happened about 50, 60, 70 years ago. Okay. That gives you Josephson constant, which is called Kj, which is 2 times E divided by H. E is the electric charge, and H is Planck's constant. Okay. So exact measurement of current actually needs the factor of H, which is Planck's constant. There was a measurement of voltage here. The voltage is measured using what is called as fractional quantum Hall effect. Okay. Hall effect, this fractional quantum Hall effect is a quantum phenomenon, not just simple Hall effect. discovered by Van Kilsing in 1980. The Nobel Prize was given to, well, not to him, but to Laughlin, Stormet, Sui in 1998 for explaining theoretically quantum Hall effect in 1998. This actually was the Van Kilsing constant, which is again H by E squared, so Planck's constant appears here. So the measurement of these voltages and currents involved Planck's constant, and therefore this measurement needed fundamental discoveries in quantum mechanics. Okay. So clearly, even if somebody had thought about balancing mechanical forces with electrical forces, before we knew quantum mechanics, especially these two phenomena, we could not have measured things to an accuracy of 1 in a billion that we needed. Okay. So therefore, the advent of quantum mechanics is very, very essential. This experiment, for example, let's say it was, this was discovered only about 30 years ago, could not have been done more than 30 years ago. Okay. So of course, things are discovered, things are accepted, people become comfortable with it, scientists accept it worldwide, and only when there is no doubt can it be used for standard of measurement. Okay. Therefore, that thing takes a few decades. Therefore, now the time was ripe to be able to use this knowledge and this technology that we had. So this is how the Planck's constant measurement has become better since 1979. So 1979, for example, so this line is the current value of Planck's constant. These are error bars. So 1979, error bars were so big. Then the experiment done by many, many different ways. Till finally now, you will see here that error bar is of this order, which is about 1 part in a billion. So the fact that we were now able to determine H to an accuracy of 1 in a billion was an important factor in doing this change now. Okay. That was the answer to what now. Such an important thing should also be confirmed by something else. And that was done by another beautiful experiment, not by using Planck's constant, but by using Avogadro's number. Okay. And this is a beautiful thing called as Avogadro project. And let me tell you what this was done. This is, by the way, supposed to be the most spherical object ever created. So this is a sphere of pure silicon 28, the particular isotope. The diameter is about 98 millimeters. But note here, it is exactly spherical to an accuracy of 1 nanometer. So from all sides, it is 94 millimeters to an accuracy of 1 nanometer. This accuracy has been confirmed by interference and using X-ray diffraction. Okay, so again, just to make this, we needed X-ray diffraction. To be able to polish this, we actually needed a particular chemical whose name I have forgotten. I remember this at some point of time. It's a very long name, which has a four-letter short form, but I'm not good with names. But however, so this was polished by expert lens makers to an accuracy of 1 nanometer. And so what do you do now? So you made this exactly spherical ball. You measure its mass, okay, which you can measure. Then you calculate number of atoms inside this. Now this has a perfect crystalline structure so that you exactly know where the atoms are placed. Okay, this has no defects. I mean, it took many years to make. And therefore, you can calculate number of atoms inside this sphere. Okay, first you know the mass. You know number of atoms, you can use that to find out Avogadro's constant in A. So in fact, this was another measurement that I will come to, which will be revised very, very soon. Now you have measured mass in whatever units you have. You have measured Avogadro's constant. They should match. Therefore, this relation, from this, you can find out what is 1 kilogram. You said 1 kilogram is equivalent to 1 by 12th mass of NA number of carbon 12 atoms. Okay. So this project was called as Avogadro project because its principal aim was to find out the value of Avogadro's constant. Once you knew Avogadro's constant, then you could multiply that by the mass of C12 atoms and divide by 12, and that answer is going to be 1 kilogram. These two measurements of kilogram that we decided, one from Planck's constant, one from Avogadro's constant, should match to within 1 part in a billion. Okay, that's a requirement. The fact that they matched is sort of evidence of the success of people who are doing these measurements. Okay, and a measure of consistency. Okay. So this BIPM, which is the convention, which the bureau which decides on what unit should be, actually self-imposed some conditions. Well, there is a committee which self-imposed conditions on BIPM that there should be at least three independent experiments. They should include both Watt balance and Avogadro project because they do things independently, one through H and one through NA. They should yield it to an accuracy of at least 50 parts in a billion. Okay, so I keep on saying one part in a billion, though just as a mnemonic, but it's actually 50 parts in a billion. So you need three measurements, these two plus one more. And in fact, there was a second Watt balance at a different place. At least one of these results should have uncertainty of not larger than 20 parts in a billion. So at least one of them should be more accurate. And all experiments should be consistent at 95% level of confidence. So it was decided that once these three conditions are satisfied, we will take the next step towards defining kilogram in terms of Planck constant or Avogadro's constant. So what happened? July 2017, all the conditions were fulfilled. There were three experiments that gave consistent values. A meeting happened not more than a month ago, so that's fresh off the press, November 2018. This was a meeting of BIPM, which is the which are the contributing states of this so-called treaty of the meter, or meter convention. India is also part of it. It was a unanimous decision by 60 member states to revise SI units. Units will be revised starting from May of next year. That's why I said that we are still in the transition state. So what now? Okay, so we have solved this problem in principle and in practice of redefining kilogram. Okay. So while we are doing this, since changing units is not something you do all the time, people had a relook at all the other units and in fact thought that some of the good ideas that we were talking about for many, many years can actually be implemented even now. This is how we defined SI units when we were in school, or in fact, not till last year. Second was given by cesium line. Meter was given through speed of light, as I explained some time back. Kilogram was given through the international prototype kilogram for the Paris volt. Mole was defined as through mass of carbon, which you have to measure. Ampere was defined through this force on wires. Oh, it required some mu naught by 4 pi. That's permittivity of free space or something. There was kelvin, which was defined through triple point of water, and candela was defined through something else. So this was the sort of network by which you defined SI units. Meter needed information from seconds and speed of light. A kilogram needed information from this. Mole needed information from kilogram and mass of carbon atom and so on. But remember, if you have to define mole as 1/12 of the mass, you also need to know what is a kilogram. Okay, so definition of mole needs kilogram and mass of carbon. So this is the network which tells you how the old SI units were defined. And now we will see how things will change. Okay, so this map is now slowly going to change. Okay, let's change it one by one. Ampere. Okay. Definition of ampere, you might remember from your school textbooks, was the following. It's that constant current which, if maintained in two straight parallel conductors, so you have two straight parallel conductors, infinite length, negligible cross section, 1 meter apart in vacuum, have a force of 2 times 10 to the minus 7 newtons per meter. Okay, I'm sure you hated this when you read this in your textbooks. I hated it. Meteorologists have been hating it for almost a century now. Okay, and therefore everyone jumped on the opportunity because we have a very simple definition available now. Because now we know what an electron is. We know charge on an electron. Okay, so simple definition that will appear now is this: is that amount of current such that electron charge is these many ampere seconds. Okay, this is something that everyone thought we should do long ago. Okay, however, note that to do this, we needed measurement of electron charge to an accuracy of 1 in a billion. Okay. This has happened long ago, however, about 50 years ago. However, now people took up the courage to do this. And therefore, from July onwards, the students in standard 11 will not have to remember this. You will actually be fine with remembering this number. Okay, and that's a very concrete definition. 1 mole. Okay, as I mentioned some time back, mole was defined as, so you take carbon atoms of 12 grams, measure number of atoms in that, so that the mass, and so on, no? Use kilogram and blah, blah, blah. Okay, so that's the amount of substance of a system that contains as many, let's say, atoms as there are atoms in 0.012 kilogram of carbon 12, which needs carbon. Okay. But you know, there's something much simpler, which is just this. It is the amount of substance that has number of units equal to this. Okay. So this, in fact, is a number, 10.23. Beyond 857, all the remaining, I think, 16 digits are zeros, okay, exactly zeros. Okay. So number NA has now been fixed forever to this quantity. And that's it. You will not now refer to carbon or to silicon or to hydrogen to define mole. Mole is just this number. Because after all, it was just a number, right? Somehow, at some point, you form this convention. So mole is just going to be equal to this number. It's not 6.023 anymore for those. It's 0.22140. So those who are interested in the fifth significant figure should note that 6.023 has changed. Okay. Anyway, so this number will now become quantum. Okay. So we did ampere, we did mole. Now we go to Kelvin. Okay. Why leave things? Okay. 1 Kelvin was the following. You look at the triple point of water. Triple point of water is the point at which, what do you have? Ice, water, and steam exist, right? You take the temperature at that point of time. You take 1 over 273.16 of that. That is defined as 1 Kelvin. Okay. It is because of this that our 0 Kelvin is minus 273.16 degrees Celsius. Okay. So this was taken as 1 Kelvin. Again, this is not a good definition, because it is very hard job to actually get triple point of water. Okay, it also depends on many other conditions, atmosphere, the fact that there should not be any currents, water should be stationary, and so on and so forth. Okay. However, now that we have got this great tool in our hand, no? I just go back and point out that tool that we have used without any noticing. Here, we use this tool that charge of electron is a fundamental constant, does not change. Right? Right. So charge of electron does not change was used to define ampere. Here, we use Avogadro's constant, number of particles that does not change. We used it to, well, keep Avogadro's constant as a fixed number. For Kelvin, we use another constant, which we know is fundamental and we know accurately, and that is Boltzmann's constant. Okay. Value of Boltzmann's constant, if you see, I always write 8 or 9 decimal places, is now known to about 1 in a billion. Now is the time to freeze Boltzmann's constant to this value. KB is blah, 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 joules per Kelvin. Okay. You know what joules are because you know what is kilogram, meter, and second. You say that 1 Kelvin is that temperature or that temperature difference such that in these units, Boltzmann constant is this. Okay, so now I define Kelvin through Boltzmann constant. Okay. So here we have used the principle that energy is the temperature is the measurement of energy. So in the of let's say the monoatomic gases, E is equal to 3/2 kT. Okay, so we know that Boltzmann constant actually is fixed constant of nature. Okay. There's something called as luminous intensity, which we don't come across often, but optics people do it. Okay. So it's defined as you take a source of particular frequency, you look at its emission in one particular angle, and you when the intensity is 1/683 watt per steradian, you call this as 1 candela. Okay. It's complicated, but it's not so big a deal. So this has not been changed. That simply be reworded in our new language. Our new language is you define a constant in some units, and you say that I define this unit such that this constant has a frozen value. Okay? So now one can analyze that unit where the fixed numerical value of lumiculus efficacy is 683. And that means 683.000 completely throughout, okay, to at least 10 decimal places. So new SI system, therefore, will be the following. Second, you measure by CZM line. Ampere, you take constant of nature, which is electron charge. Meters, you take speed of light. Kelvin, you take Boltzmann's constant. Candela, you take luminous efficacy. Kilograms, you take Planck's constant. For mole, you take Avogadro's number. So all these units have now been defined through one measurement and six constants of nature. Okay? That's going to be the new world that we are going to live in starting from May of 2019. So, what's the big deal? What does this teach you? I mean, did we do something great or did we just change something for fun? Okay, so of course I don't get heavier or taller or brighter. Okay, my luminous efficacy does not change, but that's the whole idea. Idea of changing definition of kilogram is not to change kilogram. Okay, one should not have to change any units that are currently in practice. Okay, the meter scale that you have in your lab will stay the meter scale. What we ensure that the meter scale stays the meter scale for millions of years. Okay, and not that you change it. Okay, so units should not be changed. Values of units will not change to one part in the billion. Okay. That's why we go to all this trouble to fix the value of Planck's constant H. We go down to measure all these physical constants to at least 9 decimal places so that we know they will not undergo a change. So the motto is we change it for posterity. Okay. So which means that even if no physical standards of today survive, okay, if Earth doesn't survive, but of course messages go in outer space, people after centuries will still know what exactly we meant by a second, what we meant by a meter, or what we meant by a kilogram, or what we meant by ampere. Only thing that they will need perhaps is a cesium atom. Okay, so that's the only measurement. Based on that, everything is. So we only need to measure this frequency of cesium oscillations. This can be done by anyone, anymore. If you are CZM here, you can do the HBCSE, and that means that you will have defined all the fundamental units in HBCSE lab, okay, and you could do that job in, once you measure the CZM line, in 5 minutes, okay. You don't need to go to Paris, open the vault, and see what the kilogram is. You know everything. You know kilogram, you know ampere, you know mole, you know candela, blah, 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 okay. So once you do this, the forever fixed fundamental constants allow us to reconstruct all the units. So it gives you a different way of thinking about units. Okay, so it means all units are basically the same. Okay, second is not very different from kilogram. Okay, it's not very different from meter. Okay. Then the question we face is, why do we have all these stage values? No? So these are our stage constants. Okay. C is some, some 9-digit number, H is somewhere, E has some 9-digit representation, A, blah, blah, blah. So why are these constructs of nature so strange? Why are they not simple? Okay. And the answer actually lies in our ignorance. We did not know. When we defined second and meter, we did not know that they will be related by speed of light, which will be constant of nature. When we defined Kelvin and Joule, we did not know that there will be a Boltzmann constant, which we relate Kelvin and Joule. We defined all these things independently. We did not know that they are connected. It is now, after maybe about 100 years, or depending on which units they are, that we know that all the units are connected by laws of nature, and therefore by fundamental constants. So what this change is doing, it is giving prominence to laws of nature as opposed to facts in nature, or objects in nature. We don't give prominence to a meter scale or to iridium platinum ball of 1 kilogram. We give prominence to laws of nature, and that's a major way in thinking about this. Okay, that's what I wanted to make up. You could think, make this game up. Okay, now that I know laws of nature, why do I need these units? I can use some better units. I can define natural units. I call it nat units. Okay, so maybe I define a nat second, I say, okay, I define a nat meter, such that speed of light is 1 meter per second. Right on. Okay. I define that kilogram such that Planck's constant is 1, that joule that second. I define that ampere, so electron charge is 1, that ampere that second. Similarly, that mole, that kelvin, and that candela. Why not? In principle, if the world is agreeable to change, I can define my that unit like this. Of course, it's difficult to do practically, but I want to point out that in principle, there's nothing against doing this. Okay, this could happen, which will make algebra quite simple. But of course, I'm not saying that we should do this. But as physicists, we do it very often. Okay, you might have seen at some point of time, you use c equal to 1, h equal to 2 pi, Boltzmann constant equal to 1, kT equal to 1. You would see, if you haven't seen now, you will see people doing it very often. People like me who are lazy to keep track of constants always do that. Okay, these are so-called natural units. Okay. So there's nothing great in knowing that the speed of light was blah, blah, blah. That value of 29999 came simply by coincidence. So happened that somebody defined second in a particular way, somebody else defined meter in a particular way. It so happened that the speed of light was 299, blah, blah, blah. Okay. I could have chosen units if I was brilliant enough, so that all constants of nature actually are 1. We do this. Can you think of some place where you actually use natural units while talking about anybody from astronomy Olympiad here? Okay, how far is the nearest star to the sun? About 4 light years. Okay, so what we did, we use years, which was the unit of time. We multiplied that by distance covered by light in 1 year, and we call that light year. Okay, so this conversion of time to distance unit is something that we are used to doing. This we say 4 light years naturally, right? That's the answer that people would have thought of. One would not think of trying to look at a distance as something times 10 to the power 27 meters, right? We think of light years. So it's not unnatural to think of natural units. People do think of natural units, and in fact, the fact that units are related is actually therefore important. So the thing to emphasize is that these simple things that we use in everyday life actually needed knowledge of physics, chemistry, and many of the different aspects. Defining seconds, we needed atomic physics. For meter, we needed a special theory. Kilogram, we needed quantum mechanics. Amperes, electromagnetism. Moles, we needed chemistry or atomic molecular physics. For Kelvin, we needed thermodynamics, statistical physics. For candela, we needed optics. Okay, which is to say that even for making any simple measurement in everyday life, not as a physicist, but simply as somebody who goes and buys groceries, I'm actually using the so-called esoteric physics that we think in everyday life, but it's actually is behind. Even though the grocer has a mass of kilogram, all of these things actually go behind it. Okay, and that's the message that I think we should all tell our friends who are not scientists, that that these pieces of science do go behind even defining what you do in your everyday life. Okay, so this old SI that you have now has sort of become this new SI, this new connection. Okay. So to end with, the final provocative question. Okay. All of these things depended on having a fundamental constants that do not change. Okay. So the question would be, what if the constants change? Okay. So the reason that we have bharosa on this is we have been testing them continuously. Okay, that's the job of meteorologists, to do continuous laboratory testing. We always get indirect evidences by observing the universe. So for example, the test for Planck's constant can be done by looking at sodium lines coming from stars which are at very, very large redshifts, for example. More than that, these fundamental constants are not constant just because they are measured. they are enshrined in theories like relativity or quantum mechanics or thermodynamics. So they are integral part of these theories. If the constants are not constants, the theories will collapse, and experiments, therefore, will go wrong. So any test of these theories, and everyone all around the world, many physicists are doing this all the time, is a test of constancy of the fundamental constants. Okay, and therefore, we are fairly confident that these constants will not change. Okay. Of course, if they are observed to change, we will have exciting times ahead. And as a theorist, I hope for these times to come. I want meteorologists to be proven wrong. Okay? So let's wait till May 2019. 20th May 2019 is the World Meteorology Day, because on this day, the Treaty of the Meter was signed in 1875, if I'm correct. And on that day, we will enter a new era where our kilogram will be different, where our ampere will be different, where our mole will be different. But our world will stay the same. Thank you.
Thank you, Amol. Questions?
I want to know about that silicon sphere. Where is it located, and can you tell something about how it was polished? Because polishing would destroy the crystallinity of surface layers.
Yeah. So there was, as I said, this name of the chemical which I forget, which I'll find on Google.
Process of polishing.
Yeah. So this is some chemical which can scrape things off and evaporate. Okay. So so I'm not an expert in this, but maybe we can figure it out and ask Google then. I think it's in NIST in Boulder. Okay. But I'm not sure. Okay. So.
I don't know.
Any other questions? Why cesium? I think it's just because this line perhaps would be very, very narrow.
Mm-hmm.
And the narrower the line you have, the better accuracy you have. So I suspect it's one of the narrowest lines.
Okay.
Any other questions? No questions from the students? Okay, if not, let's thank. Oh, okay, there is one question.
I heard that there is a standard meter scale using Fabry-Perot Tillons interferometer, which is also kept in the museum. Paris, which is used for the standardization of a meter scale. So any updates on that?
No. So see, for example, a standard of kilogram like this or a standard meter like this will always exist. Okay. So it will always exist, except that now that will not be the standard. That is something that will be checked, maybe every frequently, whether it corresponds to whatever we have now. Okay. So I suspect that the kilogram retirement does not mean that the kilogram will cease to exist. It will still be kept there. I think it will still be kept in the bell jar. It will perhaps still be in the museum. It will not be used to define the kilogram. That's it. Similarly, I think the meter scale still exists in the same BIPM. The meter still exists, but that's not a standard one. That is checked against the speed of light, distance traveled by light in certain times. So.
You'd shown a picture of the measurement of Planck's constant and the error bars. Not the latest one, but the ones previous to that, actually, the error bars are not coinciding with the current value. So does it mean those measurements were wrong?
Well, so that's a question for the experts. But of course, everything is within about 2 sigmas. See, remember that the condition, therefore, it is expected that there will be some fluctuations. In fact, if you see the condition, that they should be consistent to within 95%, about 95% of confidence, which is about 2 sigma. Okay, so the expectation was, let me just see if I show this. Planck's constant. Yeah, here. Yeah, so this is the perhaps something that you're referring to. Then the slightly off by the only this much amount. But remember that, so this experiment was perhaps repeated again. In fact, the two, this is here, this is Meta-S, NPL, and I think NIST has done what? This is NIST what? NIST what was repeated again to get a better measurement.
So, year 2020, textbook will be changed. Huh? Year 2020, science textbook will have change, major change, and a lot of work for publishing house, for publishing the new books and all that. So that's what I am looking
at. I don't know how long it's going to take for this thing to come, so that it change the textbook. This could be an addendum that, you know, perhaps...
definitions will be...
Yeah, some definitions
will be same. Okay.
Some definitions will change.
You said that the fundamental constants might change, but for example, the Avogadro number, Avogadro's constant may not change,
may not
right?
Change.
I mean, that's so. How do we know when something changes? I mean, do you want to say something about that?
So I'll give an example. Okay, so I gave you this example of so you look at particular atomic transitions which are coming from stars which were at a large redshift, which means that light started from them about a few billion years ago. Now suppose, okay, so let me tell you, take this for granted, that the frequency of the atomic transition lines that you see here depends on the value of h cross. Okay, it depends on h cross and c and e, some combination of e square by hc, which is alpha. So now, the atomic transition lines that you see now from that star started from there 10 million years ago, let's say. Now, if 10 million years ago, if Planck constant was different, then what I observe of those lines now is going to be different. Okay, so that's the way of checking whether the constants of nature change in time. In fact, measurement like this has been done. A few 10 years ago, there was a there were papers which said that these measurements showed that the value of this e squared by hc could be different by one part in 10 to the power minus 9. Minus 5 over 10.9 years. But of course, with more data, it turned out it is for the fluctuation. But in principle, there exist ways of checking if, simply because we can do experiments here with things that are happening here. We can do experiments, when you do astrophysical experiments, we are basically doing experiments that happened a million years ago. So we have access to experiments done now and experiments, what events that happened a million years ago. We compare the two and see if they correspond to the same physical law. So there are ways of checking this. This one here. There's a mic.
Sir, what exactly is a charge and how do we define a charge?
A charge? a difficult question. An electric charge is a property of an electron which, because of which it experiences electromagnetic force. So a charge of an electron, okay, let me put, a charge of an electron is the strength of interaction of electron with light. So that will be a good definition.
Say, do we know the origin of charge, like where it has come from?
So that we'll go back to Ganesh, for example, so his talk. But at some point of time, so in science, you define certain things and then you proceed from here. Okay, you can understand what a charge is in many, many different directions. Okay, one was this as electron and photon coupling. One is saying that there's something called as, physicists like to describe nature in terms of what is called as gauge symmetries. And discharge comes as the strength of the gauge symmetry of an electron's wave function. You can think of this as the strength by which electrons or particles will repel or attract each other. Origin of charge is a very difficult question because the question, I think, is it will take some time to define the question well. No? What do you mean the origin of charge? What kind of answer are you looking for?
We know that particles gain mass by interacting with the Higgs field. So where does the charge come from exactly?
That is it, interacting with the electromagnetic field.
Electromagnetic.
Exactly the same. In the theories we have, there is no difference between particles getting mass from Higgs field to particles getting charge from. So particles' mass is proportional to its interaction with the Higgs field. Similarly, particles' charge is proportional to its interaction with electromagnetic field.
A very practical question. See, we have standards, primary standards, kept somewhere in Paris as of now. And finally, I get a meter scale from a stationary store. What could be the error? I mean, will it impact the measurements? OK, forget grocer's shop, but the laboratory experiments which you do, what kind of error can it introduce? I mean.
So the this particular change?
Not the change. I mean, if even in the old system, you are making a primary standard, secondary standard. Finally, you get a meter scale from a shop, stationary store, and use it in the lab also. So what is the kind of error I can expect?
Well, so usually the error in the instrument is at least expected to be less than its least count.
Yeah, what I call a meter on a meter scale, which I buy from my shop, and the real meter, how much difference can be there?
I don't know. I would expect it to be smaller than a millimeter, simply because the least count scales are of millimeter. And of course, in the lab equipment, which claim to be able to measure it to greater accuracy, I would expect that they have reproduced the meter to that much greater accuracy.
Okay. But there are no numbers like, I mean, it's 1% off, or I mean, any such.
So this error will decide what is the standard of the equipment.
Okay.
High standard equipment will have low error.
Okay.
And that will also, I guess, the cost of experiment equipment also will be proportional to kind of. It's difficult to say just by your comments.
Okay, I think now we'll take the tea break for about 20 minutes. Professor Dighe will be available outside. Let's first thank Professor Dighe for his talk again.